And I will have a talk about the outcomes of my master's thesis on single sign-on security and the security analysis of real-life OpenID Connect implementations. But before I will start, I would like to introduce myself. I studied at the Ruhr Universität in Bochum and completed my master in 2020. My master's thesis was, as already mentioned, on single sign-on security. The advisors of this thesis were Christian Meinka, Vladislav Mladenov, and Jörg Schwenk. Right now I'm working at USD AG as a pen tester, and in my free time I'm doing security research and publish blog posts from time to time and publish a bit of tooling from time to time. But without further ado, let's start with the topic of this talk. At first, I would like to talk about the security analysis aspect of the thesis, and then would like to focus on five observed common issue patterns within the test set. And afterwards, I would like to open the discussion. I have some proposals, but I think they are all open for discussion. So maybe we can spend a bit of time regarding the discussion part in the end. So let's start with the security analysis. If you would like, you can also have a look at the thesis because the definitions are way more formal than the and are way more detailed than I could go into detail in this presentation, of course. At first I would like to start with the selection of implementations that were covered in my thesis. The main objection to choose these implementations was as all of them allow to either configure custom identity providers or custom service providers. Some of them support to configure both. So for instance, KeyCloak can be used as identity provider as it's on its own, but you can also configure identity providers against KeyCloak as it is an identity and access management tool software. There's a separation between self-hosted software and remote services. So for instance, Amazon Cognito is obviously an AWS service and was not hosted on our hardware during the analysis. Okay. Regarding the evaluation setup, we have one local setup that was created on a laptop device, pretty simple. The software was set up using Docker, and we had an intercepting proxy that was configured within the front and back channel so that we could observe all protocol communication. We also implemented a custom identity provider and a custom service provider implementation. Very, very simple, but this enabled us to control the complete flow and to adjust even small parts and to craft each protocol message manually. The remote setup was a bit more complex. As you can see, obviously the services do not run on our machine. These are cloud services. Used a vServer within the UniCloud, and the intercepting proxy was exposed to this vServer. So it was also possible to, analyze the front channel completely and parts of the back channel communication together with the custom implementations that were also run on the server. We had also the possibility to. There are questions in the chat. I don't think that is for this talk.
I think it's a comment from Giovanni regarding the Pixie
statement. Ah, okay.
Yep.
So okay. Sorry, it was just an answer to the previous question. Sorry, Lori.
Don't worry. Okay. Fine. Yeah, so the remote setup was comparable, but the services were obviously not run on our machines. The attacker models that I will use in the following are also described in way more detail in the thesis, but in the following I will outline the capabilities of the different attacker models that were applied. So for instance, the web attacker model that was used for some of the attacks we will investigate in the following was introduced in 2008 by Bart et al. And what a web attacker cannot do is intercept and eavesdrop for communication that is not intended for them. But web attacker can obviously convince a victim to visit a controlled website, send and receive HTTP requests on their own, provide a trusted TLS certificate for their own controlled domains, for instance, attacker.com. So they can provide a TLS certificate and communicate encrypted. And they can additionally, what was added for the thesis, have an user account at the identity or service provider, a native account, if needed. The second attacker model that was used is the malicious identity provider, which was introduced in 2016 by Meinka, Ladendorff, and Schwenk. And what a malicious identity provider can do is they can perform regular benign OpenID Connect flows, but additionally, they can send malformed OpenID Connect flow messages. They can tamper with the ID token claims, tamper with the key references. So they are not restricted to the normal regular OpenID Connect flow. Obviously, there are some requirements for this. So either the service provider must allow dynamic OpenID provider discovery, or the service provider must configure an identity provider that turns then evil at a later point in time. So we assume that the identity provider is already configured at the service provider. So there is this trust relation, but we consider the identity provider as an independent third party. Yes, in this setup. The third attacker model is the malicious service provider, and likewise the identity provider. The service provider can obviously perform a regular OpenID Connect flow, but can also send malformed OpenID Connect flow messages. For this attacker model, it is required that the client is either manually registered at the identity provider, or that they can register on their own, for instance, using OpenID Connect dynamic client registration. The key point is here that we also assume that the service provider is configured at the identity provider and has a valid client ID and client secret client credentials pair. And the very last attacker model we will cover in this talk is the malicious administrative user, either at the service provider or identity provider, which was introduced by Matsumoto et al. In 2014. This attacker can basically modify the complete configuration, specify endpoints and algorithms. There's an obvious requirement for this. So the attacker is a high privileged user, which comes with some limitations, especially regarding self-hosted services. So in a self-hosted setup, the administrative user is commonly a trusted user, and this attacker model might not have such a great impact in this self-hosted scenario. But in a service, a cloud scenario, administrative normal users do not have access, for instance, to the internal network, for instance. And one side note, if there is the possibility to use dynamic client registration or OpenID Connect discovery, then in most cases, we do not even need this attacker model. It was only introduced for completeness. Okay, these were the main attacker models that were used. And now let's talk a bit about the evaluation catalog. It was based on previous research and security best current practice, and additionally completed with some own attack ideas that were then checked against the real world implementations too. It was categorized in identity provider and service provider test cases. I think I will not go too into detail here. There are many categories, and it were quite big assertion catalogs that were tested against both the remote services and the local implementations. And in the end, there was a thorough evaluation. This might be a bit overwhelming. So if you are interested in the details of this evaluation, I recommend to have a look at the thesis. In this talk, we will have a look at five patterns, and here are six classes. So one category is for IDPs and SPs. So we will discuss this in one pattern that was observed. So I would like to go over this quite quickly and jump right into the observed patterns. The very first pattern that was observed in real life implementations was that the redirect URI allows any scheme. So for the authentication response, it is normally a redirect to the redirect URI, and the specification says that the redirection URI should use HTTPS, but it may also use HTTP. And if you read a bit further, for native applications, it can also use an alternate scheme. So basically every scheme is allowed. So this might also include JavaScript, Visual Basic script data, if there is no restriction in place at all. So where's the issue in this case? For instance, for KeyClock, which we use as an example in the following, we see that the authentication response is a 302 HTTP redirect, as it is commonly used. Within the location header, there's the redirect URI. So you can configure a valid redirect URI that includes the data scheme. Then if you complete a normal login flow, KeyClock responds with the location header, and as you can see, it uses the data scheme. And for some browsers, for instance, latest Safari, this script is actually evaluated and executed. The impact of this is a bit limited, as it as the JavaScript is not executed in the context of the IDP in this case, but still you can achieve JavaScript execution, limited JavaScript execution, using a data URI with inline HTML. This pattern was, for instance, observed in KeyClock, but also for Amazon Cognito. So this the observation was that the redirect URI allows dangerous, potentially dangerous schemes. The second observed pattern was login confusion. And this is one of the novel attack ideas that were introduced with the thesis. So I would like to explain this a bit more. There are some preconditions that need to be met. So in order to apply this attack pattern, the very first is that there needs to be a login cross-site request forgery. What is this? There needs to be either the specified login initiation endpoint, which enables third parties to start a login flow. And this endpoint was already outlined by Fett et al. To be an intentional CSERF protection bypass in 2017. So this is a well-known a well-known endpoint that is vulnerable to CSERF attacks. Also, there are some implementations that use a non-normative endpoint that can be used to start authentication, for instance, Bitbucket. These endpoints are often used internally. So if you click on the user interface to log in using OpenID Connect, then there's at first a redirect to this endpoint on the application, and this endpoint starts a login flow, a regular login flow against the identity provider. So if these prerequisites are met, and additionally the victim has an active session at the identity provider with an account that has also an account at the service provider, we can basically log in the victim into their own account, because in most implementations I observed, there's a silent immediate redirect after the auth request is sent to the IDP, so that in the end the victim has a fresh session at the service provider, which is itself not a problem and is often ignored, but this can still lead to problems, as we will see in the following. The second precondition we need to have is that there is a non-normative next URI query parameter. So many implementations use a parameter to track where the user should be sent after successful login. So if, consider you have a user that starts their journey at an endpoint that requires a login, for instance, the inbox. Then at first the user is sent to the login and the destination after login is tracked within this query parameter. The user then authenticates, and after the authentication was successful, they are sent back to the starting point, which was tracked with this parameter. So if you combine both aspects, we can create something that was named login confusion. So the scenario is we have a user that has a native account, user A, and a single sign-on account, user B, and additionally an active session at the identity provider. Then what we can do as an attacker, a web attacker, is we can send the victim somehow to this URL that includes the login path and additionally the next URL parameter with the already known non-normative endpoint that starts a login flow. Then the user authenticates with their native account, user A. So from the user perspective, they only enter their credentials for user A. Then after successful login, the victim is redirected to the external login endpoint, which then immediately starts a silent OpenID Connect login flow. As the victim has an active session for user B at the identity provider, there's an immediate silent auth response back to the service provider, including a valid code and a valid state. And finally, the service provider completes the flow by redeeming the code and is logged in as user B in the application. I have another visualization for this. So the regular login would be the user enters their credentials for user A, clicks login, and in the end is authenticated as user A as expected. If we now perform such a login confusion attack, at first the user visits the attacker controlled website. They are sent to this specially crafted URL, which holds the malicious endpoint, the external login endpoint in the next parameter. From the user perspective, all user interaction that is performed is they enter their credentials again and click login. After the login was successfully performed, the service provider sends the victim now to the external login endpoint. This is a covered redirect using the next URL parameter. As we can see, this starts immediately in login flow with the identity provider. So the victim is redirected to the identity provider. At the identity provider, as the victim has already an active session as user B, they are immediately redirected back to the service provider, including a valid code. And as the service provider then completes the flow, in the end, the user is authenticated as user B. So from the user perspective, they start with entering the credentials for user A. All other redirects are hidden, silent. Normally, the user does not recognize that this is ongoing. And in the end, they are still authenticated as user B. So this pattern was named login confusion because it may confuse our victim if they have two accounts at the same application. Maybe one single sign-on account for work and one native account for private. They may confuse and disclose sensitive information this way. This pattern was observed in quite many implementations, for instance, KeyClock, GitLab, and Amazon Cognito. So all of them used an internal endpoint, not the specified endpoint, to start the login flow, which was then not protected against CSERF and was exploitable to perform such a login confusion attack. Okay. The third pattern that was observed was the state reuse that could enable denial of service. The authentication response is a redirect to the redirect URI, as we already heard. The specification of this state already outlines that it is that this state should be bound to a browser cookie. The best current practice additionally outlines that the state should be invalidated after its first use. So there is already a strong recommendation that the state should be one-time usable and should be invalidated after first use. And we discovered one additional threat that could happen if this is not the case. So what we discovered is the denial of service amplification pattern. So we used basically the service provider as an amplifying proxy for requests. The scenario for this is we would like to DOS an arbitrary web server by sending many requests, but only spend limited bandwidth on our own. So the attacker model here is a web attacker from a limited perspective, but mainly a malicious IDP or a malicious administrative user could benefit from this observed pattern. At first, we configure, as if we consider the malicious IDP or malicious administrative user, at first we configure a victim server as token endpoint with an additional long path of the URL and a long client credentials. We then start an OpenD Connect login flow and obtain a valid state from the application, the service provider. Basically, we only need to save one valid auth response, including the state. Then in the third step, after the auth response was received, the service provider as normally tries to redeem the received code value at the victim web server. And this request, the token request, can be multiple times larger than the attacker's request, especially as we have some parameters where we can optimize this with a long path and a long client credentials. The request that is actually outgoing from the service provider could be many times larger than the minimal request that an attacker can send. And what the attacker then is able to do is to replay the obtained auth request and basically repeats step three many times. If there is no additional rate limiting in place, each request results in a multiple times larger request that is sent to the victim web server. So to show this in a little picture for you, the attacker basically needs to send the auth response, the state, and the outgoing token request then from the client is many times larger and hits the potential victim. Obviously, the web attacker is very limited in this case, so they are not able to configure an arbitrary web server as victims, so they can only hit the token endpoint. This attack is way more powerful if we consider the malicious IDP or administrative user in this case, because they can, for instance, configure at a cloud service an arbitrary web service as target and start one login flow and then rapidly only redeem the auth response in order to trick the client to perform this DOS attack, DOS requests. This was observed that the state was reusable for Bitbucket and GitLab, for instance. That's it. The next pattern is server-side request forgery. And as you can see, we have multiple vectors for server-side request forgery. All of these vectors were already known. So the interesting part in this is that even though this that these attacks are well known and were already discussed, we still observe them in real life, in real-world implementations. So let's start with the request URI parameter. This is a parameter that can be sent along the authentication request. And the specification outlines that if it is supported, the identity provider then fetches a request object from this URI. So if this is implemented and enabled, this allows basically unauthenticated server-side request forgery, as it was already outlined by Fett et al. In 2017. And the interesting part here is that KeyClock, as a very popular implementation, was vulnerable to this and fixed this in January 2021. And the default configuration for each client was vulnerable to this. So there was hardly a possibility to even disable the request URI parameter before. So even today, we commonly observe misconfigured KeyClock instances regarding this aspect. if you maintain a Keycloak instance, you may would like to have a look at this. I'm not quite sure how the update was performed and if this broke the configuration somehow. Maybe even clients that were set up before January 2021 and updated, maybe even still vulnerable. So you may want to check this. The second vector for server-side request forgery are malicious endpoints. This is a pattern that was identified by Nadenov and Meinka in 2017. And this basically utilizes the endpoints that are configured for the regular OpenID Connect flow. If there are no restrictions in place regarding internal IPs, this enables blind server-side request forgery to the internal network just by misusing the regular OpenID Connect flow. So you basically configure a local host or internal IP address as token endpoint, and then the token request is sent to the internal network. The outcome is blind, so you could observe something if you can determine different timing or even receive error messages. This could enable you to perform, for instance, port scans of the internal network. And one concrete example for this was AWS Cognito. They had input validation in place for the graphical UI configuration. So here there were input fields to configure manually configure the endpoints. But if the discovery was used, it was possible to simply configure localhost with a known with a chosen port, and then it was possible to observe the error messages. So if we configured for instance, port 22, we received an error message, connection reset, which is interesting. If we configure instead port 20, then we get a different error message, connection refused. So this directly enabled us to perform port scans. The error message disclosure was even worse, as it also reflected somehow the HTTP codes to us. So if you hit an actual web server internally, you are additionally able to determine the response in regard of its HTTP response code. So with this, you can you get much information about the underlying TCP connection and even HTTP response status codes. The request UI was only present in Keycloak during our tests. SSRF issues were even more common regarding other service provider implementations, for instance, GitLab and, as mentioned earlier, AWS Cognito. The last observed pattern was injection issues. So it was as the main issue, I would say, in this case is that service providers trust values that are provided by identity providers, and that this enables a risk for instance, XSS and SQL injections was previously discussed also by Fett et al. But besides these injection types, the identity provider values, provided values are also used in even more context, for instance, within HTTP headers. And if we have a look at the specification regarding the access token, it's quite open, I would say. So it starts with, yeah, it can have multiple formats, its structures. And if you only follow this RFC 6749, the main RFC, you may come to the conclusion that that it would be fine to just take the access token and use it within the HTTP headers. Of course, there is RFC 6750 that restricts the character set basically to base 64, which is, of course, reasonable and the right way. But still, if this is not followed by implementations, this could lead to serious issues as when we have a look at the RFC for HTTP, Request lines, so also general request headers are separated by CRLF sequences. So carriage line, carriage return line feed sequences. So if we were able to inject such a sequence, this could potentially have a quite worse impact. So if a service provider does not sanitize these access tokens sufficiently before they are used within the user info request, for instance, a malicious identity provider could, for instance, inject arbitrary HTTP headers into the user info request. As we saw earlier, SSRF to the internal network is an issue. And generally, to mitigate SSRF, cloud providers tend to use HTTP headers. So the common mitigation against SSRF to the internal endpoints is to enforce HTTP headers, like here for the example for Google Cloud, only requests that include this metadata flavor HTTP header have an actual impact in the internal network. And with this primitive, if the access token is not sufficiently sanitized, it is potentially able potentially possible to inject arbitrary HTTP headers. Besides this, we could also inject completely new requests by splitting the HTTP requests. So you basically add more CRLF sequences, and the outcome is that you can send multiple requests with one request that you issue. And as the identity provider can additionally control even the target of these requests, this is quite dangerous and might lead to serious SSRF issues. To illustrate the issue once again, we have this flow here. And the interesting part is the token response. And within the token response, our identity provider includes an access token that includes a CRLF sequence. The client uses this access token without proper sanitization. And as a result, within the user info request, we have the bearer token, the injected CRLF sequence, and then the injected payload. So in this case, it was actually possible to inject arbitrary HTTP headers. For the demonstration, we did not alter the user info endpoint, but as outlined earlier, potentially we can specify the user info endpoint arbitrarily. So we can also use any other endpoint that does not point to us as malicious identity provider in this case. Issues regarding injections were discovered in Bitbucket, GitLab, and Salesforce, but the Bitbucket issue was not related to the CRLF sequence. The category injection covered more than this type of injection. The most interesting CRLF injection was discovered in GitLab. Okay. To sum up, these are the five observed patterns I outlined in this presentation. And I would like to open the discussion regarding possible security considerations that could be made after hearing these potential threats. I prepared some proposals. For instance, to start with, the redirect URI could allow only schemes that, or the other way around, there should be a restriction regarding potentially dangerous schemes. What do you think about this?
Well, I'll give a comment. I'm George Fletcher, the identity architect at Yahoo. For mobile apps, I would hope that everybody's using the, you know, universal links or app links provided by iOS and Android, which are basically HTTPS, right? Which could allow you as an IDP to, you know, reduce, you know, have a allow list of schemes. Which I think could be useful. Whether that works in all you know, deployments, I think is questionable because depending on what the environment is, you may not have that sort of, you know, platform level security mechanism for your redirect URIs.
Okay. Yeah, but your point is basically that most URIs already use HTTPS, so the restriction, there could be a restriction?
Well, so in the mobile app world, right, so sort of ignoring, let's say, a native application on Windows or, you know, or Mac OS, in the mobile application world, I would say the majority of redirect URIs are still custom schemes. It's just that there are a number of other security issues with custom schemes, right? The platforms are arbitrary as to which app gets invoked. So, you know, so that's kind of where Pixie came from, right? To try and help prevent against that. There's also impersonation issues and other stuff that happen, right? And a malicious app can take over a public client because the only piece of information that's there is the client ID, right? So I can impersonate pretty much any public client today. The universal links and the app links mechanisms give you some protection against that impersonation, good protection in the case of iOS, mostly good protection in the case of Android. And because in both cases, your redirect URIs for those platform level protection mechanisms are HTTPS, you know, again, depending on what kinds of clients you are serving, you could reduce the scheme restrictions and make it much tighter. So I'm in favor of this as a you know, sort of mitigation perspective. I just think that in some cases it may be you may have to use a block list depending on what kinds of clients are connecting.
Okay, I agree with this.
Lawrence, this is Philip Kahn from Alt0. There's also a recommendation in the app auth PCP for whenever custom schemes are used. And I would say, you know, your data in JavaScript that falls under the custom scheme part of, you know, redirect URI flavors. And that BCP talks about it being recommended to enforce or to use reverse domain schemes as your custom schemes. So an authorization server that actually enforces this recommendation would not already allow JavaScript data and VBScript and similar, because they do not contain a dot character which would denote a reverse domain notation.
Okay, I was not aware of this. Thank you. So the next thing were that the endpoints that allow CSERF, login CSERF, could be a bit more restricted, or should at least have a referral whitelist, I think. So this would mitigate most of the issues, I think. Do you have any comments on this? Are they used in the wild, even the external login endpoints, initiated login endpoints?
Again, open redirectors of any kind are already prohibited.
Yeah, this is not quite a open redirector because it's only an endpoint that starts the login flow. So you do not have any control where you are redirected. You redirect the end user to this endpoint, and this starts basically a login flow. So the user clicks on the user interface. They are sent to an endpoint of the application, and this endpoint starts the login flow and includes within the redirect then the state and all other values that are sent to the IDP. For this purpose, this endpoint is often used, as I saw it. And in this case, you could restrict the referrer. So if the only origin that should send requests to this endpoint is your own application, you could whitelist your own application, the referrer of your own application. So then you are basically safe against this login into own account CSERF stuff. And regarding the login confusion attack. I was muted. The next point is, if solely the state is used, which I'm aware is not longer recommended and will be highly disrecommended with OAuth 2.1. If this is the case, the state should be one-time usable, I think, but I don't think this is much discussable because it's already a hard requirement, or it is recommended as it should within the RC. I think the next point is more interesting. The request URIs parameter is, up to my knowledge, only specified within the dynamic client registration extension. So in my observation, some developers that implement this request URI parameter are not aware that there might be, or there would be, a whitelist that they could implement. So my suggestion would be that there should be something like a hint for developers that if they decide to implement this request URI parameter, they should consider implementing this request URIs parameter too. And the very last thing I brought is that there could be a hint regarding the structure of access tokens, as apparently some clients are not aware that this is a potential act, potential vector for attacks. Some SPs even responded, or their security teams responded to us with, they do not consider the identity provider as a malicious entity at all. But as it is a more and more common practice to allow customers to specify their own identity providers, corporate identity providers, I think this is an evolving attack vector, and that there could be something like a hint that this is a particular a danger if you allow your customers to specify their own identity providers. Okay, if there are no comments left, then I would like to thank you for your attention. If you have any comments or questions and do not want to speak out, feel free to reach out via Twitter. My handle is here or in the bottom right here. And then I would propose to make something like a short coffee break, as there was no break between the last talk and this talk. And then the next talk will start, I think, in 15 minutes.
Right. Thank you, Loritz. So.